Good evening, everybody. Welcome. Good evening. Good evening. We're just going to wait a few seconds to let everyone join us and see our participants coming in quickly now. Evening to those just joining us. We're just letting everyone pop into the webinar and then we'll get going. Good evening. Good evening. If you're just joining us, we're just giving it a few seconds to let everyone pop in. Good evening. Hello, still people popping in.
Hi, everyone.
Right, we'll just give it a couple of seconds. Right, let's get going. Good evening, everybody. There's a few folks still joining us, but we'll get cracking and they can catch up as we go along. So good evening and welcome to our latest winter online roadshow. This is our 15th roadshow now, I think, in our winter series. So very warm welcome to you all. My name is Kerry Porteous and I'm your host this evening. I'm one of the operations managers in the Naturetrek office. I look after a plethora of different tours from northern Sweden down to Madagascar and very many places in between, including quite a few destinations that my colleagues here will be talking about this evening. So as well as being your host, I'm hoping to be able to answer lots of your questions as we go through the night as well. So normally we'd be out on the road this time of year. We'd be visiting hotel venues, meeting you face to face, which sadly we can't do this year. But it has been an absolute pleasure to be able to bring these online roadshows to you instead. And in fact, we've met so many more of you doing it this way that it's been a real success. We've extended our series now, so we are now into the extended run of the online webinars, and we're going through to the end of March or thereabouts, by which point hopefully it'll be a bit brighter in the evenings, a bit warmer, and we'll be all able to get out and out a bit more again. If there's any destinations that we haven't yet covered that you'd be really keen for us to talk about in the future, just let us know. You can email info@naturetrek.co.uk and that will help us shape our plans for the future, as I'm sure we'll be keeping these webinars in some format in future years. For anyone that's brand new to Zoom and this is the first time you're joining us, then please do not worry, we cannot see or hear you, just the panelists and the spotlight tonight. So you're welcome to go about making your cups of tea or whatever it is as you go through the evening. There is a chat function that you're very welcome to use. You'll be able to see when you send the message that you can either send it just to us as panelists or you can include everyone, so all participants. If it's something you think that other people on the webinar might like to hear or comment on, then by all means include everyone. It's really nice to create that sort of atmosphere. Just be aware that if you're on an iPad, if the chat function is popping up a lot while someone's speaking, it can be quite distracting, but you can mute it. There's a little bell symbol in the corner, so you can just mute it and hide it away until the interval or until our question and answer session at the end of the evening. On that, there is a question and answer function as well, so have a look at that. If you do have questions for us, then I'd encourage you to put them in that questions box, and then we can keep track of them much more easily than if they're in the chat. So you can ask us anything you like this evening about any of the tours we're talking about and about the travel industry in general, whatever it is you'd like to put to us, just pop it in the question answer box. We'll type answers as we go along through the evening. Anything that we haven't come back to, we'll pick up at the end. And we'll also read out a few of the more common questions just in case others might like to hear the answers to them too, just at the end. So from 9:05 onwards. If you are on our mailing list, you'll have received our brochure in the last few weeks. So I hope you've enjoyed thumbing through it and dreaming of travel when we're all able to get out and about once again. If you haven't received our brochure but would like to, then please again just email us info@naturetrek.co.uk and we'll get one in the post to you. And if you think you should have received one because you think you are on our mailing list but nothing's arrived yet, then again, just let us know because it really should have been with you by now. So we'll check what's happened there. So this evening we are heading to Africa, arguably the greatest continent on earth for wildlife, with some fantastic mammals, fantastic birding, so much to see there. So we will be kicking off in West Africa, and I think gradually moving east as the evening goes on. I will let my colleagues introduce themselves to you when they come to speak, but I'll just say that I'm delighted to be joined by Georgie, who's our tailor-made holidays manager from the office, and three of our prestigious tour leaders, Ben, who is also a former member of the operations team in the office, and then two of our longest-standing and wonderful leaders, Bob Mileto and Tim Melling. So without any further ado, I am going to hand over to Ben, who is going to start off the evening by taking you to Ghana and the Gambia. Over to you, Ben.
Great, thank you very much, Kerry. I will just try and get this presentation going. So as Kerry said, my name is Ben. I worked full-time for Naturetrek from 2018 to 2020, but I'm now based at Imperial College and the Zoological Society of London, doing research into the effects of climate change and ecotourism on African wild dogs. And I'm going to be speaking tonight about two countries in West Africa. The first will be Ghana, and then we'll talk a little bit about Gambia at the end. Now, Ghana is a country in West Africa. It's bordered to the west by Ivory Coast, to the north by Burkina Faso, and to the east by Togo. It's about 240,000 square kilometres in size, which makes it almost exactly the same size as the UK, with a population of about 30 million people. Broadly speaking, the southern section of the country falls within the rainforest zone, and the northern half of the country within the Guinea savannas. In the rainforest zone, it's generally not too hot, but humid. And in the north, it tends to be very hot, but much more dry. We have two different tours that visit Ghana. One is a 14-day Ghana's Highlights tour, which takes in some of the best rainforest sites, as well as going up into the north to visit Mole National Park, which you can see in the northern part of this map. And a shorter 10-day Ghana Picathartes and Pangolins tour, which focuses on the rainforests of the southwestern part of the country, making a particular effort to try and see not just the amazing yellow-headed Picathartes, but also having a go at trying to find pangolins. Now, the first reserve that a lot of tours will visit in Ghana is the Shai Hills Reserve. This is quite close to Accra. And although it's in the southern part of the country, it is mostly savanna habitat. There's a band of savanna that comes down quite close to the capital. And because of that, lots of the birds that are found here are much more similar to those found in the north than to the communities found in the rainforest zone. One of those species is the stone partridge. It might look like a francolin. There are lots of different species of francolin and spurfowl around Africa, but in fact, it's a species of New World quail. How exactly this species made it to West Africa when its closest relatives are thousands of miles away across the Atlantic, I don't think anyone is completely sure, but it's a lovely little bird. Violet Chiraco is one of the key species to see in the Shai Hills, really spectacular birds. And Chiracos are unique in that they're the only birds on Earth that produce true red pigmentation. Other birds produce red coloration, but using a feather structure rather than actual pigments. This is the yellow-crowned gonalec, a skulking species, but a gorgeous bird and one that usually gives good views with a bit of patience. Blue-bellied roller is another species that's a key target in Shai Hills. The rollers are a gorgeous family in general, but I think this really does deserve to be considered one of the most attractive of all. And although our Ghana's Highlights tour doesn't visit Shai Hills, because it does visit the northern savannas of Mole, many of the species that I just mentioned, if not all, should be seen on that tour as well. Kakum National Park is probably Ghana's most famous rainforest reserve. It's maybe 3 or 4 hours drive from Accra, and it's most famous for this incredible canopy walkway. And although it might look slightly rickety, I can assure you from personal experience that it's extremely well built. And it obviously gives a fantastic opportunity to get eye level views of a really wonderful variety of birds that you would otherwise have to endure a very sore neck to see at all. And one thing that's important to stress is that the canopy walkway comes off the top of a hill, which is very close to where the reserve headquarters are. So there, to get up onto it, there's no ladders, no sort of horrible flights of steps that need to be negotiated in order to get up. And some of the species you can see from up here include, in particular, a really nice range of hornbills, from black dwarf hornbill, which is the smallest hornbill species in the world, through the amazing and unique white crested hornbill with that incredible long tail, right through to some of the real giants of the forest hornbill world, like this yellow-casked hornbill. Birds of prey are often sort of visible from the canopy walkway too. This is the amazing long-tailed hawk, and lucky groups might even get the chance of spotting the near-mythical Congo serpent eagle. Lower down in the canopy, you get other special birds like this rufous-sided broadbill. After dark as well, there is a really exciting range of birds and other wildlife to see. This is the Unkulengu rail, which is a bird that up until about 20 years ago, I believe, had never been photographed in the wild. But in the last few years, particularly some of the guides that we've used in Ghana ourselves, have made real advances in understanding how to track this bird down. And particularly around dusk, when they start calling, there's a really good chance of finding a bird as it settles in to roost. This is another iconic and enigmatic nocturnal bird. This is the Akun eagle owl. Across West Africa, it's generally extremely hard to find, but Ghana seems to be the one country where it's encountered with some regularity. It's not just birds. This is a West African potto, which is a species of nocturnal primate that is part of the same broader group of primates that includes the lemurs. And especially around the area of the Kakum National Park headquarters, you stand a really, really good chance of seeing this species. Now, another group of species that are sometimes visible in Kakum, and certainly when I went to the park myself a couple of years ago, were right at the top of my wish list, were pangolins. This is a black-bellied or long-tailed pangolin, and it's unusual amongst the eight species of pangolin around the world in that it's principally diurnal. They'll tend to spend the first few hours of the day basking in the sunlight at the top of the canopy, which means they are occasionally seen from the canopy walkway itself. And then after that, they'll move down lower into the canopy to feed. And that's often when the best sightings occur, because they're quite noisy. And then they're sort of the noises they make can sometimes give them away. Now, of course, you know, I'm sure many of you will know pangolins are the most trafficked wild mammal in the world, and they're becoming rarer across their range. And there's nowhere where, you know, any of us could honestly say that you stand there's anything like a sort of guaranteed chance of seeing a pangolin in the wild. But Ghana does seem to be somewhere where they're doing reasonably well, does seem to be a stronghold. And if you're going to look for them all in the wild anywhere, then Ghana really is the place to do it. The second reserve, second rainforest reserve I'd like to talk about now is Ankaza. Ankaza is in the far southwest of Ghana, near the border with the Ivory Coast. And it's Ghana's largest primary lowland wet rainforest. And because of that status, it supports a range of wildlife, including mammals and birds, that are really confined to the largest pristine tracts of rainforest. And on the mammal front, that includes some really spectacular species like African forest elephant, bongo, and chimpanzee. It's very hard to see those on a short visit, although there's a lot of evidence of the elephants around. But most of the attention in the forest goes to birds. This is the yellow-billed turaco, which is a common species around Ankaza and usually quite easy to see. This is blue-headed wood dove, another really attractive species that's easier to hear than it actually is to pin down. But a lot of the most exciting birding in Ankaza focuses around a series of ponds deep in the forest. And these can provide opportunities to see some really elusive and rare species, including this is African finfoot, white-crested tiger heron is another really sought-after species that's occasionally seen on these ponds. This is Hartlob's duck, a species that's mostly confined to wetland within primary rainforest in Western Central Africa, a really beautiful species. And Ankaza also provides an opportunity to see a really exciting range of forest kingfishers. This is blue-breasted kingfisher, which is quite a widespread species, but it's also possibly the best place in the world to see white-bellied kingfisher. Shining blue kingfisher is a possibility too, as is African dwarf kingfisher. I'll just take a moment to talk about accommodation, not just in Ankaza, but in Ghana in general. Generally speaking, the quality of accommodation is very good. The facilities are good. The accommodation is clean, sort of well-constructed, well-appointed. There aren't any frills, however, and you're not going to find the same level of accommodation you might find in high-end eco lodges in other parts of Africa, per se. But really, it's perfectly suitable for our purposes and provides access to some really spectacular wildlife. Now, I'm going to try and show a video now for a couple of minutes, which should, I'm hoping, show you what it's like to go and see the yellow-headed Picathartes, which I think for a lot of people is the birding highlight of a trip to Ghana. This is Bonkro Village, which is the starting point for the trek to the Picathartes nesting site. There are two different nesting sites that you can visit, that tourists can visit in this forest. One is about an hour walk from the village. The other is slightly, slightly less far. Most of that walk to both locations is over even ground through really nice forest, although the last few minutes of the walk in both cases is a little steeper because you have to get up to these the top of these rocky hills where the birds are breeding. And the Picathartes, they nest on these amazing caves or enormous isolated boulders in the middle of the rainforest. And we tend to try and get to these caves about an hour before sunset, because even though the birds don't breed at the time of year when our tours visit Ghana, they roost at the nest sites year round. And generally speaking, within about half an hour of arriving, we tend to start getting some really nice views of these really bizarre birds. They were thought to be extinct in Ghana for over 100 years until they were rediscovered in 2003. And since then, a thriving kind of ecotourism operation has built up around them. They are bizarre birds. They are not closely related to anything else. There is another species of Picathartes elsewhere further south in Africa, but otherwise they have no close relatives. And I think a lot of birders would consider them to be not just one of the most sought after species in the whole of Africa, but also in the whole world. And they really are. It's a spectacular species to see. And very confiding too at the nest sites, although very shy away from them, and often provide really, really wonderful views as you're sitting there. We generally leave well before dusk to make sure that we're back in the village well before it gets dark. But it is a wonderful, wonderful experience. And honestly, I can say one of the highlights of my sort of birding career so far. These are just a few pictures that I put in case that video didn't work. But again, a really wonderful, fantastic bird. And since the discovery of this breeding colony near Bonkro, there have been some really big efforts to try and make sure that the population is protected. The colonies are in community forest, so there is no formal protection, but the money that tourists bring in when they come in to see the birds has funded a program of schools construction. It's funded a program to encourage locals to stop poaching. And that's had some really positive effect. I think it's a really great example of how ecotourism can be a very, very valuable to conservation. And one of the side effects of that community protection has been, it seems, a real uptick in the population of pangolins around the reserve. And while both of our tours visit the Picathartes forest to see the Picathartes, our Picathartes and Pangolins tour spends a few nights in this community forest using the help of local guides to try and locate both black-bellied pangolin, this one here, and white-bellied pangolin, which is its nocturnal counterpart. And although I really do have to stress that there's nowhere in the world where you can say that pangolins are guaranteed, this provides, I think, with the best chance there is, although again, I do have to say that it's not guaranteed and there's always a chance we could miss them. I'm going to talk quickly now about Mole National Park, which is the principal savanna reserve in the north of Ghana. It's about 5,000 square kilometres in size, which makes it one of the largest reserves in the whole of West Africa. This is the view from the Mole Motel, which is where we stay in the park. It's a really beautiful view out over much more classically African habitat than you might have found in the southern part of Ghana. And unlike lots of other national parks in Africa, you can do a lot of your birding out on foot, which is a refreshing change. And the habitat is very open, which is a nice contrast from the more dense rainforest habitat. So lovely savanna birds. This is lavender waxbill on the left and red-cheeked cordon bleu on the right. Red-throated bee-eater, it's a gorgeous species that's abundant in these open habitats. This is northern red-billed hornbill. Abyssinian ground hornbill. This is the northern counterpart to what is perhaps the more familiar southern ground hornbill, which is a species that's often easy to see in eastern and southern African reserves, and the main difference being the blue facial skin rather than red around the eye. Some great nocturnal birds to see if you go out at night as well. This is greyish eagle owl. This is long-tailed nightjar. And if you're lucky, might even get a chance of seeing standard-winged nightjar. It's a really bizarre species to see. If you see it in flight, it really does look like it's being chased by two small bats and can be quite confusing if you're not sure what to expect. It's also probably the best reserve in West Africa for mammals. One of the most conspicuous is this. This is Buffon's cob, but other species include waterbuck, warthog and bushbuck and some really nice other species like that. It's also probably the best reserve in West Africa to see savanna elephants, particularly actually in those ponds right below the lodge where we stay. They often come in the middle of the day to cool off in the water. And some of them have these tusks, which are really quite straight, which to me are more reminiscent almost of the tusks of forest elephants than some of their savanna counterparts in other parts of Africa. The last site I want to quickly talk about in Ghana, which is close to Mole, is a site on the White Volta River, which gives you a chance of seeing Egyptian plover, which is one of West Africa's most sought after birds. It's in its own family, which makes it quite significant for global birders. And its alternative name is the crocodile bird, supposedly because it goes into the mouths of Nile crocodiles to pick out rotting meat. It's a name that's stuck, although it doesn't seem like there's any properly documented evidence for this actually occurring. They're very used to people, and you can often get very close to them. This is obviously, I don't know if you can see the bird, just put an arrow there to make sure you can. But you can often get very, very close up views. And our tours to Ghana run between November and March, which is generally the dry season, although you can get rain all year in Ankaza. But generally speaking, the climate is nice. It's not too hot and not too humid, especially in the early hours and late hours of the day when we're mostly active. I'll just spend the last few minutes of my talk talking about another West African country. This is the Gambia. The Gambia is a tiny country that's entirely surrounded by Senegal. It's really nothing more than a river surrounded by a little bit of land. But given its tiny size, it really packs an enormous punch when it comes to birding. It's a particularly popular and great place to visit during the British winter. There's no time difference. The climate is really pleasant. And there are some spectacular birds to see. We have two tours that visit the Gambia, a bargain birding tour, which runs between late October and early November, and then a Gambia in style tour, which runs every month through the dry season from November through to April. And in contrast to Ghana, where, as I mentioned, the quality of accommodation is absolutely fine, but not luxurious, the Gambia in style tour allows you to do some really wonderful birding while staying in really very comfortable accommodation. These are the Mandina lodges that we stay at. Some of the rooms are right out on the water. And really on the inside, it's really a very luxurious kind of surrounding to be staying in. Quite a lot of the birding from the lodge here will be out by boat, which gives an opportunity to see a really wonderful range of water birds, pied kingfisher, giant kingfisher, and malachite kingfisher on the bottom right. And then the rest of the time we'll be out walking from the lodge. And this can provide an opportunity to see a really almost bewildering variety of colourful birds. And especially if you haven't been birding in Africa before, I think the Gambia is a really, really wonderful country to visit because it combines sort of ease of access with some of the continent's most spectacular species. This is Abyssinian rola, a beautiful sunbird. Violet chiraco again, which is another species that's easy to see both in Ghana and in Gambia. This is Western red-billed hornbill, another member of the red-billed hornbill complex. A pearl-spotted owlet. This is a really interesting species to watch because, especially when it's calling, it often brings in a lot of other small birds which come in to mob it. And so if you have a guide, sometimes they'll imitate the call of the pearl-spotted owlet, specifically to bring in other species. Hooded vulture, it's a critically endangered species, but fortunately one which remains commonly seen in Gambia. I'll just briefly mention then the bargain birding tour, which stays in a much more basic quality of accommodation, but as well as spending time near the coast, near where the Gambia in style tour stays, it also goes up the Gambia River. And if you want to see Egyptian plover in Gambia, then this is the tour that you really need to go on, because it's the upper reaches of the river and the sandbars there in the dry season where you stand a great chance of seeing this really iconic bird. Thanks very much. On that note, I think I will hand over to my colleague, Georgie. So thank you very much for listening.
Great. Thank you very much, Ben. I will just share my screen with you all now. Right, hopefully you can all see and hear me nice and clearly now. So my name is Georgie Head and I am Naturetrek's tailor-made manager. Now, for those of you who don't know about our tailor-made department, we are really the bespoke private arm of Naturetrek. So if you've ever wanted to do one of our group tours, but perhaps the dates didn't work for you, or you wanted to just go as a couple or an individual even, or even as a family or a group of friends, then that's where tailor-made can really help. So we can offer very similar itineraries to our group tours, but we can also offer holidays to other destinations, other national parks that we might not get a chance to visit on our group tours, or even different countries that we don't visit on our group tours. So if there's a specific species you want to see, or if you want to focus on photography, or if you're just looking for something a little bit different, then please do get in touch with us and our tailor-made team, as we'd be happy to help. I'd also encourage you to take a look at the new tailor-made section on our website, or you might even like to order a copy of our tailor-made brochure, which hopefully should provide you with plenty of ideas and inspiration. But that's enough about tailor-made. This evening I am going to focus on Uganda and Rwanda, which are two countries that I know particularly well. So Naturetrek don't currently offer any group holidays to Rwanda. We offer two group holidays to Uganda. So that's what I will primarily focus on this evening during my presentation. But at the end, I will quickly go over Rwanda and the differences between the two countries. And of course, we'd be happy to organise a tailor-made holiday if you are interested in visiting Rwanda. So as you can see here, Uganda is a landlocked country. It's got borders to Ethiopia, Kenya, Tanzania, and Rwanda. And it combines really well with all of those destinations if you're looking for a longer safari holiday. So these are all the national parks that we will visit on our group holidays to Uganda. We offer two holidays, as I mentioned earlier, our In Search of the Shoebill, which is our birding tour, a 9-day birding tour, and our Mammals and Mountains, which is our mammal focused holiday, which is 11 days long. So both of them follow a very similar route, going in an anti-clockwise direction across sort of the southwest of Uganda, as you can see here. The main difference between the two being that our birding tour doesn't visit Windi as standard. But that's not to say that if you are a birder, you're necessarily going to have to miss out on the gorillas at Windi. We can easily organise an extension for you if that's of interest. So both of our tours start here in Entebbe. It's not actually the capital of Uganda, but it is where the international airport is located. So we'll spend one night in Entebbe. We might visit the botanical gardens, where there's some great birding to enjoy just on the shores of Lake Victoria. So it's a lovely relaxed start to the holiday, but we'll be up very early the following morning to start our journey to the Mbamba swamps. Now, this is what we'll be searching for during our time in Mbamba. This is the shoebill stork. So these incredibly impressive birds stand at around 3 to 5 foot tall. They're incredibly rare throughout Africa, and Mbamba really offers our best chance of seeing them. They occur in the swamps, and we will take them out, some dugout canoes to go and see the shoebill. But we won't stick around for too long, as we will then continue on with our journey to Lake Mburo. So I thought I'd briefly just mention the vehicles that we travel in during our holidays to Uganda. There are quite a lot of road journeys involved in all of our group holidays, and indeed in any holiday that you'll take to Uganda. So it's really important that we have comfortable vehicles, and these Land Cruisers are brilliant for that. But they will also double up as our safari vehicles. And they've got these great pop-top roofs so that when we are out on safari, we can get a 360 view, and they're great for photography. Our Uganda tours are also capped at just 6 participants, so that means that everybody will get a window seat on the tour, and it also helps create a really nice tight-knit group. You'll get to know your guide really well, he will get to know your key interests, and so that's a really nice highlight of a tour to Uganda as well. So as I mentioned, we will continue on to Lake Mburo, which is around a 5-hour drive west of Entebbe. And Lake Mburo is so named for its largest lake. It's actually got 14 crater lakes in the park, and we'll make good use of those during our time in Uganda. We'll go on boating safaris in search of species such as this African finfoot, which is a wonderful bird. We might see some Sitatunga antelopes, which are very shy, elusive antelopes that we'll see sort of on the margins of the water. This will also be our only opportunities to see zebra in Uganda. You can only find them in Lake Mburo, and equally you can only find impala in Lake Mburo. And we can take walking safaris during our time here. This is the only park where we will be able to enjoy walking safaris, and that's something really nice to do after the long flights particularly. We'll also take some night drives in search of species such as this African scops owl. And in the evenings, we will go out at dusk in search of pennant-winged nightjars, which can often be seen around many of the lodges. Speaking of the lodges, this is Rokobo Rock Lodge, which is one of the typical lodges that we will use around Lake Mburo. It's quite a standard style of accommodation that we will use for all of our group tours. Very comfortable, lovely staff, it's very well appointed. I would say if you visited some of the very luxurious lodges in parts of southern or eastern Africa, this probably isn't quite up to that standard. You may find that the service, although always with a smile, it can be very slow at times. So as long as you've got some patience, I'm sure you will enjoy it. And as I said, these lodges are so well appointed, and I'm sure you'll enjoy that. So we will then move on to the Bwindi Impenetrable National Park, or those of us on the mammal tour will anyway. And this is really likely to be a highlight of the tour for the mammal enthusiasts amongst us. And this is the reason why, the mighty mountain gorilla. So mountain gorillas are a real conservation success story. In 2018, they were taken off the IUCN's critically endangered list as their numbers reached over 1,000 for the first time. You can only find them in Uganda, Rwanda, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. You can't visit the DRC at the moment because it's not safe to do so. So if you want to see mountain gorillas, you're going to have to head to either Uganda or Rwanda. So people often ask us how a gorilla trek works, how does the day pan out? So you will arrive at the gorilla headquarters first thing in the morning, and you'll be split into groups of up to 8 people and will be allocated your gorilla family there and then. So the groups are very roughly allocated based on perceived ability of fitness. So the very sort of strong, able-bodied amongst us might be given a group which they know will be sort of a good 6-8 hour trek away, whereas those who look like they might struggle might be given the closer gorilla families. Now, that's not to say that you should come ever expecting an easy trek. It might be that on the day that you visit, all of the gorilla families are a 6-hour trek away, so there are no easy options on that day. It might also be that a family that was previously close the evening before has moved a long distance in the night, so they are more difficult. So you must always come prepared for quite an arduous trek. People therefore ask us how fit you need to be to join a gorilla trek. And the answer to that is always very difficult for us to answer, mainly because people's sort of perceived level of fitness can vary so much from person to person. But generally we would say if you are used to some kind of moderate daily exercise, for example, dog walking, then you should be fine. But if you have any concerns at all, please always phone us in the office and we can talk through your individual circumstances and discuss whether or not a gorilla tour might be suitable for you. So when we arrive with the gorillas, we will have one magical hour to spend with them. And it really is a completely magical experience. So gorillas share 99.9% of their DNA with humans, and we'll really get a feel for that when we're out with them. They will be interacting with each other, and you can get a sense of their intelligence and their emotions. And it really is one of the world's most incredible wildlife experiences. But because they share so much of our DNA, they're also quite susceptible to some of our diseases. So it's incredibly important that we must always maintain a distance of at least 7 meters from the gorillas at all times. You should still get some great photos, and it's still a really wonderful experience. So they might be out in a clearing, or they might be sort of back in some vegetation, as you've got here with my first gorilla trek a few years ago. We'll generally find that the silverbacks are very relaxed. They will completely ignore our presence, but the babies can be really quite inquisitive, and it can be quite difficult to maintain that 7 meter distance, but it's very important that we do so. But we'll spend a wonderful hour with them, and it really will be an hour you will never ever forget. It's not all about the birding though. Sorry, it's not all about the gorillas. There is birding as well. So Bwindi is fantastic because it's also a location where we can find some of the Albertine Rift endemics. Now, these are a really range restricted group of birds that you can only find around sort of Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi areas. So we'll be on the lookout for red-throated alethe, grower's warbler, and a lot of other really star species, which are quite difficult to find elsewhere. It's also great for primates and a whole host of biodiversity, really. We'll see Lajos monkeys, colobus monkeys. It's actually one of Africa's oldest forests, having survived the last ice age, so supports an incredible biodiversity of wildlife, and we'll take the time to enjoy that while we're here. We will then quickly move on to the Queen Elizabeth National Park. So this is probably Uganda's premier game reserve. It's a savanna national park, but it has lots and lots of different habitats. And this is one of the species that we will be looking for during our time in Queen Elizabeth. These are tree climbing lions. Now, tree climbing behavior is very unusual in lions and can really only be seen here and around Arusha in Tanzania. Nobody really knows why they do it. It might be to keep away from the biting insects. It might be to get away from the heat in the trees, or it might be just to get a better vantage point. But it is very unique and it's fascinating and a lovely part of a visit to Queen Elizabeth. We'll also see lots of other species. These are Uganda cob, not quite endemic to Uganda, but we'll certainly see them in good numbers here. And we'll see plenty of other sort of typical East and Southern African wildlife. We'll see leopards, elephants, buffaloes, hippos. So they all occur. I would say if you have taken a safari in certain parts of Southern or East Africa, you might be slightly disappointed with the abundance of wildlife to be found here, which can be less than in your sort of Kenyas or Tanzanias, for example. But what Uganda does have going for it is that if you're willing to put in the work, there are far fewer tourists here, so you can have a much more exclusive safari experience. This is the Kazinga Channel, which is a real highlight for the birders amongst us. It's a natural canal that forms between Lake Edward and Lake George, and is a real magnet for bird life. So on one of our afternoons in Queen Elizabeth, we will go out on one of these pelican boats for a couple of hours, where we hope to see up to 80 species of birds. So those include pelicans, cormorants, kingfishers, bee eaters, all kinds of waders and water birds. It's not just about the birds though. We will also see lots of lovely mammals on this trip. We will see elephants, buffaloes, hippos, Nile crocodiles, and it's a really lovely, relaxing way to spend one of our afternoons in Queen Elizabeth. We will then move on to the Chibali National Park, which is where we will go to see our chimpanzees. So chimpanzee trekking works in quite a similar way to gorilla trekking, in that we will have to buy a permit to do it, and we will get exactly 1 hour with the chimpanzees. So although the trek to see the chimpanzees is generally a little bit easier than the one to see the gorillas, when we do get to the chimpanzees, it's a much more active experience. We will hear them a long time before we see them. They will be screeching, they are loud. They live in big groups of 30 to 100 individuals, and they'll constantly be on the move and we'll be trying to keep up with them. So it's a really nice contrast to the sort of more sedate gorilla experience. It's also a great part for primates. We've got 11 species of primates that we can see in Chobali, such as these colobus monkeys, and we'll take some time to walk in the forests as well as in Chobali. So that takes us to the end of our standard group tour of Uganda. But for anybody who's got a bit of extra time, I would highly recommend visiting the Murchison Falls National Park. So this is actually Uganda's largest game reserve, and it is so named for the Murchison Falls, which are on the Victoria Nile. It's a gorge just 8 metres wide and the drop is 43 metres. So the sheer force of water that comes from here is very impressive indeed. And we can take boat cruises to the bottom of the falls. We can walk to the top of the falls if we'd like to. But most of the time we'll be enjoying some further game drives. Now, Murchison Falls is Uganda's only Big Five game reserve. It's the only place we will find rhinos in Uganda. And it's also the only place we will find giraffes, such as these Rothschild's giraffe. So it really is a lovely place to end the holiday. So that's sadly all I've got time for on Uganda this evening. There's lots of other wonderful parks that we could visit. There is Kadepo up in the north, got Semliki to the west. We might like to spend some time in Jinja on Lake Victoria. So if you'd like to know any more about those or any of the other parks I've talked about this evening, please do pop your questions in the Q&A section and we'll answer as many as we can. But before we end, I will briefly go to Rwanda, which, as you can see here, is this tiny country in just southwest of Uganda. And these are the three national parks that we will visit if we are on a wildlife safari in Rwanda. So we will begin with Akagera National Park, which is Rwanda's only savanna national park. So it used to actually be much larger, but unfortunately after the genocide in the 1990s, the park faced a lot of problems with poaching, with deforestation from the number of refugees who were displaced following that horrible incident. But thankfully in the last few years, an organization called African Parks have taken over Akagera and taken over the management there. And they're doing an absolutely fantastic job at reinstating the park to its former glory. They've reintroduced lions and rhinos successfully to the park. So for those of you who have done a few safari destinations and are looking for something a little bit different, spending time in Akagera and working with the researchers and conservationists is something really different, and I'd highly recommend it. So we will then head to Nyungwe, which is where we will go and see chimpanzees in Rwanda. And again, this experience is very similar to the one in Uganda. I personally found the trek slightly more difficult in Rwanda, but that may well have just been the day that I went. They can vary so much between days, these experiences. But it is exactly the same in that we will have exactly 1 hour to spend with the chimps. A lot of the time they may be up in the trees. We might just see a lot of chimpanzee bums as we're walking across. But hopefully at some point during our hour, we will get to see them on the ground and get some fantastic photos of them interacting. Nyungwe is also one of the best parks for primates anywhere in Africa, really. They've got 13 species of primates. So you've got your grey cheek mangabey, there are silver monkeys, and we can also track habituated colobus monkeys in Nyungwe as well. And finally, we will head to the Volcanoes National Park. So this is where we will go to see gorillas in Rwanda. And people often ask us what the difference is between trekking in Rwanda and Uganda. And to be honest, there aren't huge differences between the two. One important distinction is that it's much more expensive to trek for gorillas in Rwanda. The gorilla permits actually cost $1,500, whereas in Uganda, they just cost $700. But the experience itself is very similar. You'll start the day with their gorilla headquarters being split up into your groups, and then you'll go and spend exactly 1 hour with the gorillas again. One of the main differences, however, is that you may well start a gorilla trek in Rwanda in some of this sort of cleared pastoral land which surrounds the forest, whereas in Uganda you will almost always immediately start your trek right in the heart of the forest. You will quickly get into the forest though, so that doesn't necessarily make it any easier as your gorilla family may be well into the forest as well. And this is the kind of habitat that we'll have to make our way through. It's well worth it though for the fantastic hour that we will get to spend with the gorillas. And as I said earlier, it's very similar to the hour that we will spend with the gorillas in Uganda, but it will be one of the best hours you've ever spent in your life. So highly recommend it. Rwanda is also fantastic for birding. This is a Ruwenzori churiko. It's great in that you can see a lot of those Albertine Rift endemics that I mentioned earlier. So Rwanda is a great birding destination. This is a regal sunbird, which is another one of those very special species. So that brings me to the end of my talk on Rwanda and Uganda, my very whistle-stop tour. As I mentioned earlier, please do pass through any questions into our Q&A, but I will now pass you back to Kerry, who I believe will be taking us to a break.
Thank you so much, Georgie, and thanks to Ben, who kicked us off this evening. Yeah, as Georgie says, we'll take 10 minutes now just to go and top up drinks, grab some nibbles, whatever you'd like to do, and we'll kick off again at 8:25. So we'll look forward to seeing you all then.
Bussa, let me swim up. Bussa, don't have a. Jumbo, Jumbo Bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana, wageni, mwakaribishwa, Kenya yetu, hakuna matata, sote jumbo.
Jumbo, Jumbo Bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana,
wageni wetu,
wageni, mwakaribishwa, Kenya yetu. Hakuna matata,
Kenya nchi nzuri.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi ya kupendeza.
Hakuna matata,
nchi yenye amani.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi yenye umoja.
Hakuna matata,
Kenya nchi nzuri.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi yenye amani.
Hakuna matata,
nchi yenye wanyama wengi.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi yenye.
Hakuna matata,
sema jambo.
Jambo,
jambo
bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana.
Wageni wetu,
wageni, wakaribishwa, Kenya yetu. Hakuna matata,
sema jambo.
Jambo,
jambo
bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana.
Wageni wetu,
wageni, wakaribishwa, Kenya yetu. Hakuna matata,
Kenya nchi nzuri.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi ya kupendeza.
Hakuna matata,
nchi yenye amani.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi yenye umoja.
Hakuna matata,
Kenya nchi nzuri.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi yenye amani.
Hakuna matata,
nchi yenye wanyama.
Hakuna matata,
tena nchi yenye umoja. Sema jambo.
Jambo, jambo bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana.
Wageni wetu,
wageni, wakaribishwa, Kenya yetu. Hakuna matata,
sema jambo.
Jambo, jambo bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana.
Wageni wetu,
wageni, wakaribishwa, Kenya yetu. Hakuna matata. Habari gani, nzuri sana.
Wageni wetu,
wageni, mwakaribishwa, Kenya yetu. Hakuna matata.
Welcome back, everybody. Hope you're all suitably refreshed and drinks are topped up, because Rob is looking more than ready now to take us to Kenya for the next 15 minutes. So over to you, Rob.
Thank you, Kerry. I thought I'd at least try and set the mood by getting dressed for a safari. So I hope you can all hear me well. I'm going to talk about Kenya.
You're a tiny bit quiet, Bob. I wonder if you just move slightly closer to your microphone.
I can move closer to my, shall I move closer to my microphone? Is that better?
Yeah, that's a little better. That's perfect. Hello? Yeah, go for it.
Excellent. Okay. Let's go screen sharing. So, come on, behave yourself. There it is. So, Kenya. I'm Rob Mileto. I have been a Naturetrek leader for far longer than I care to remember. And I'm going to whistle through Kenya in 15 minutes is the time allotted to me. Naturetrek run 5 tours currently to Kenya. I haven't got time to cover them all, so I will focus on 2 of the most popular and very briefly mention a third. Birds and or wildlife of Kenya's Maasai Mara are 2 trips. They follow the same route that you're looking at now, both starting in Nairobi, heading off towards Naivasha, and then southwest to the Maasai Mara itself, which I'm sure you all at least have heard of. This trip is 10 days, and really the difference between the two is the focus. The birds tour, you'd never guess it, focuses on birds. The wildlife tour will also look at birds, but we'll spend more time looking at other things, be they mammals or plants or reptiles, whatever the group feels they want to spend most time looking at. So it's normally a daytime flight to Nairobi, overnight there, and then off to Lake Naivasha, where you will stay at the Elsamere Lodge, right on the shore of the lake. It's a lodge made famous by the Adamsons, who lived there for some time. The Adamsons, as you may know, wrote a book called Born Free, later made into a film, and also a song. And in these green and luscious gardens, you will see all manner of birds. Some of you will have seen these in other photos from other leaders, but the thing about Kenya is they tend to seem tamer and very colorful. This is the superb starling, well named, given its coloration, about the same size as our starling. Not to denigrate our starling, but this is so much more colorful. And you will see these throughout the trip to Kenya on whatever trip that you do. Another gorgeous bird is the little bee eater. And one of the nice things about the little bee eater, as well as some of the other birds that you'll see in this presentation, is they sit still. They tend to sit waiting for an insect, e.g. a bee, to fly past. They will then fly out, hawk it, bring it back to the perch, beat it to death on the branch, and you get the opportunity for a photo. Not so still, but does hang around on occasion. This is the variable sunbird. You'd have thought they'd given it a better name than that, given its colourful iridescent plumage, but because it does vary in its plumage, it got the name variable sunbird. Lots of these around Elsamere. The African paradise flycatcher with its unfeasibly long tail, which is about 30 or 40 centimetres long in the male, again, quite commonly seen in and around the lodge that you'll be staying in. But Naivasha is famous for its water birds. You will go out onto boats, tour around looking for the water birds along the edges and in marshy areas. And here we have a black heron and a sacred ibis. You've probably seen the black heron on wildlife documentaries. It's the one that does the umbrellaing of its wings. Nobody's quite sure why it does it, possibly to give itself shade in order to spot the fish and invertebrates that it feeds on, possibly because that shade is actually attractive to the fish and the invertebrates and brings them closer in. African fish eagle is another speciality of the lake, and your guide will often throw in a bit of fish and it the eagle swoops in to get it, and you've got a chance for a photo opportunity if you're a photographer, or just enjoying the spectacle if you're not. Great white pelican, very common on the lake. And again, because they're used to people, they will often fly in close, and you get chances of good close-up views of birds like this. Oh, wrong way, apologies. Not quite sure why it went there. And we're back. Giant kingfisher, lovely perched on this particular branch, about the size of a jay, if you want to give it some context. That's why it's a giant kingfisher, stonking bird. There aren't many mammals around in Naivasha. You will see those in aplenty when you get to the Masai Mara. But this, as most people know it, the black and white colobus, given a fancy new name now called the Mau Forest Guereza, but who's going to call it that? And obviously in the lake, you will find these hippopotamus. And of an evening, they will even come out to the shore. So you just have to be a bit careful, but you can see them in there. Full glory if they do come out of the lake. So from Lake Naivasha, you drive down westwards, to the Masai Mara, famous for its rolling grasslands, and you can sit literally on your balcony or in the edges of the lodge, sipping your wine and watching the wildlife come to you. There are reasonably extensive grounds that you are safe to walk around in, because those grounds are protected by the staff and will tell you if there's something dangerous around. And so you can do some local birding and mammal watching in the immediate locality. Your accommodation, you're camping. Who'd believe it, eh? You are camping, glamping really, as it's called these days, in big permanent tents. You have a massive bed, you have an ensuite bathroom, and in that ensuite bathroom, you have running water and showers. What is not to like? That's not camping the way I know it. A typical safari day, if you've been on safaris, you will know, does involve getting up early in the morning. That is by far the best time to see the wildlife. You go out in your stretched Land Cruisers with the pop-up tops and the slidey windows, just as all over Eastern, Southern, and even Western Africa. There are six people to a van, so everybody gets a window seat. If it's appropriate, you will have a breakfast out in the wilds. I was going to say under the shade of a tree, but you're not getting a lot of shade there. Lots of open rolling grassland, so nothing to obscure the view. These are the sorts of terrains that you're going in. There are some dips and depressions, but with four-wheel drive and excellent local guides, there's no chance of really getting stuck or missing out on anything. This is a picture of the view, and it was photobombed by a topi getting in on the act. This is one of the classic East African antelope. And they are resident, whereas a lot of the other grazers are migrants, and we'll talk about the Great Migration in a moment. Here's another picture of the view, this time barged in by an elephant, of which there are many, and you can see how it gets the name to a degree. Masai Mara is because it's the land of the Masai, and Mara in the Masai language is dotted or spotted, because it is dotted with bushes and trees throughout the grassland. And in those bushes and trees, that's where the predators tend to hang out, because they can then use the cover to ambush their prey. Here's a couple of lionesses staring at us, thinking, is that edible? No, it's a van, we'll ignore it. It's also a good place to get some shade in the heat of the day. So often under a shady bush, you will find male lions. This one's just about, see, it's on a kill, which is an unfortunate buffalo just to the right. And they are so used to seeing vans that they pretty much take no notice. Early in the morning, it's not really particularly hot. So these little lion cubs were quite happy to sit out. And again, they were fixed on something and just completely ignoring us, even though we were probably, what, 6 meters away? This is not a telephoto lens photo. It's a very good place for cats, especially this cat, a cheetah. This one, as cats do, sleeping under a bush. With the wide open spaces, they have no problem sneaking up and chasing their prey at high speed. This one, not so good at finding shade, a leopard hiding. And in the heat of the day, that's what you'll find them doing. But with a bit of patience, and because we go out mornings and evenings and generally spend the heat of the day back at your lovely luxurious tent, you can spend the time just seeing what happens. And eventually they will come out, scan the landscape, see if there's anything on the menu, or if they're feeling thirsty, they'll go down to a small waterhole and take a drink. And this is not uncommon by any means to see in the Maasai Mara. It is really one of the top mammal spotting safaris in the world, probably certainly in Africa. Hyenas also are plenty. This one taking a bit of a snooze on the edge of a pond, having, by the looks, dipped its bottom to cool itself down first. Blackback jackal, this is a pup. Again, very relaxed, no problems about approaching it, doesn't get stressed at all, just another van passing by. So what are all these things eating? They are eating meat on the hoof. Here's one of them, a Thompson's gazelle. Number in their thousands, preferred prey of cheetahs, which can easily run them down. Zebras. This is plain zebra or Burchell zebra. Very common, part of the Great Migration, which I'll talk about in a minute. Note the stripes. The black stripes are narrower than the white, and they have these sort of semi-grey brown shadow stripes in between. I mention that because we'll see something similar, but not the same later. Cape buffalo. Big herds of those. You can't really miss them. They're really the prey of the lions. They, with those big, hefty horns, you don't mess about with them unless you're a pride of lions that takes the young or the sick or the ill. But this is what most people probably think about when they think about the Maasai Mara. These are wildebeest which can number 1 million in the Maasai Mara. And from July to October, that's when they're there. They then go on a clockwise journey into the Serengeti, around the Serengeti, and then back to the Maasai Mara. July to October is when they typically are there. The Naturetrek trip gets there in October, hopefully catching this, which is wildebeest on the march, crossing rivers, again, like David Attenborough and the like have made famous in the likes of Perfect Planet. But with this amount of movement of animals, there is death on the plains. And after the lions and the hyenas have had their fill, you get the likes of vultures. This is a white-backed vulture on the right and a lappet-faced vulture, the largest of the sub-Saharan vultures on the left. You will have no difficulty seeing these. They've got nowhere to hide. Once the vultures are done, you often get eagles coming in, picking off the scraps. This is a tawny eagle, very easily seen in the Maasai Mara. And then I will quickly whip through a large number of birds that you can see. These are ones that perch nicely, so it's easy to get photos of them. Photographer's favorite, the lilac-breasted roller, very commonly seen. Grey crane, lovely bird. Red and yellow barbit, the name says it all really. Quite often purchased for long periods. Secretary bird, lots of these, stalking the plains, mostly looking for insects, but they do stamp and kill and eat snakes of a certain size, if that's about. possibly my favourite, the northern carmine bee-eater. That is a bird and a half, and there's a very good chance of seeing these. Probably not getting a photo like this. This is one from a photography tour, which there is a specialist tour just for photographers that does go here. And that is a whistle-stop tour of the Mara tour. This is a very quick oversight of Kenya highlights. It's a slightly longer tour. The Mara tour that I just showed you is 10 days. This is 14 days. It also starts in Nairobi, heads north to Samburu, pops over to Mount Kenya, off to the lakes Baringo and Bogoria, Nakuru National Park, which is also a lake, and then ends up in the Mara. I will very, very briefly rip through what you will likely see on this tour. One thing you'll see is this, not necessarily the person doing the handstand. You can celebrate the crossing of the equator at your choice. Handstands are optional. My daughter decided that would be the way to do it. And then you end up in Samburu, very dry areas you can see, lots of acacia scrub, but that doesn't mean you don't see wildlife. It means that they tend to concentrate around the waterholes. And that's where I got this photo, which is of Grevy's zebra, hence why I said, look at the zebra. This has the stripes that are narrower. The white is narrower, the black is thicker. It gives it a look of being more black than white. It has no shadow stripes. It also has stripes all the way down the leg and a white belly. This is a speciality of Samburu that you won't necessarily see elsewhere in Kenya. And so is this. The Bisa oryx, very similar to the Southern African oryx that you can see in Namibia, Botswana, but is a distinct species. And the Jerinuk, half antelope, half giraffe. The reason it's got a long neck is because it can also stand on its back legs and reach leaves that other gazelle cannot reach. Commonly seen in Samburu. Amongst the birds, you have this, sort of the largest bird in the world. This is actually the Somali ostrich, which occurs in northern Kenya and into Ethiopia. Tim may mention it. South of that, it's the common ostrich. Very similar looking, but this one has a bluish tinge to its skin, especially the male, whereas the common ostrich has a pinkish tinge to it. From the biggest to one of the smallest, this is actually the smallest falcon in Africa. Almost the smallest one in the world. This is a pygmy falcon, about the size of a big sparrow, if there is such a thing. Tiny little thing, feeds mainly on insects. I was gonna call this the ugliest one that you'll see, but you know, this and the marabou stork, who knows? This is a vulturine guinea fowl, but lurking top right, there is a helmeted guinea fowl for comparison. The vulturine has this stripy look about it, the helmeted, the spotty look. Commonly seen in Samburu, very difficult to see elsewhere in Kenya. Mount Kenya, second highest mountain in Africa, just over 5,000 meters. You'll be pleased to hear you don't have to climb it. You will spend most of the time in the forests on the edges of it. Forest birds are very difficult to get photos of, and I've also gone over my time, so I will briefly show you this, which Ben also showed you, pearl-spotted owlet, but Ben did not tell you what its call is like. So I will try and whistle it now for your amusement and my embarrassment. It goes. It's a daytime owl, and that call brings in lots of small birds to see what is going on, spot the owl, make sure they're not the next meal. And if you can do it better than that, when you haven't got a dry mouth, it brings in the birds as well. Lake Baringo. This is not your accommodation, you'll be pleased to hear, but this is the first place that I visited in Africa way back in 1988. The accommodation was a bit better then. Not that much better, but a bit better. You'll be pleased to hear that we don't stay here. But the lake was then 100 meters from this accommodation. lake levels have risen a lot. Nobody's quite sure why, possibly rainfall, possibly tectonic movements. But all this dead wood that this has generated means the bird life can be spectacular and often is spectacular, especially things that like dead wood and dead wood invertebrates, like Jackson's hornbill, which will also nest in dead trees, Nubian woodpecker, and moving swiftly on, Lake Borgaria, where this is a soda lake, all the ones we've seen so far are freshwater. Soda lake means flamingos, the pink fuzz is flamingos. You get a bit closer, there they are, lesser flamingos, often in large numbers, but flamingos being flamingos, you can go there and see nothing. That's wildlife viewing for you. You've just got to hope that they're there on the day. The other thing you get at Borgaria, is lots of waders. And unlike in Britain, where you go to estuaries and they're about 1,000 miles away, and even with a telescope, they look like a dot, on the lakes in Kenya, they're really close up, really tame. This is wood sandpiper. Many other sandpipers and other waders are available. Lake Nakuru and Lake Nakuru National Park. It is not all lake. You can see how the levels have risen, but there is still grassland, there is still forest. And on that grassland, there are white rhino. Reintroduced, they used to be there, they got poached out, they've been reintroduced, they're protected. You cannot miss them. And then you head off to the Mara. And I've talked about the Mara, so I will leave you with a sunset shot, because always end on a sunset shot, and there just happen to be a couple of cats in it too. Thank you.
Right, thanks for that, Rob. Hi, everyone. I'm going to talk to you. My name's Tim Melling. I've been leading trips for Naturetrek all over the place for since the late 1990s, over 20 years. I tend to go to colder places. So when they wanted to send me to Africa, they said, well, if it's high altitude, that'll be a little bit colder for you. So I end up with Ethiopia. So this is Ethiopia's wildlife highlights, and I'm going to take you through a few of the places and the things that you're likely to see. So Ethiopia, there it is, just north of the equator. The thing, it's about five times the land area of Great Britain. It looks quite small when you see it in Africa, but Africa is so massive, it really is a big place. But the thing that sets it apart is the altitude. The central plateau is about 5,000 to 9,000 feet, and that's the Norbit, and parts of it go much, much higher to over 14,000 feet. I'm going to start off in the Simien Mountains, which is right in the far north, overlooking Eritrea. And you can see the spectacular landscape here. The chap with the gun there was our mandatory guard. They're terrified of anything happening to visitors to Ethiopia and getting it a bad name. And they don't want these ruffians coming from Eritrea to kidnap tourists, not that it's likely to happen. So they make you have a guard with a gun who sits there bemused whilst you're watching the birds and mammals. But when he sat down there guarding, I thought, actually, that makes quite a nice photograph. So I took his photograph, and then the next minute he asked me for my shirt. Don't forget, it's about 9,000 feet above sea level, chilly, and I wasn't intending a swap. He loved me. So I politely declined that one. So because you're in such high cliffs, you're actually looking at eye level or even down on raptors, and you can get some fantastic views of them. This is the Rapel's griffon vulture, which is another seriously declining vulture in Africa for a number of reasons that I haven't really got time to go into now, but you see lots of Rapels there. And this is the rarest vulture in Africa. This one now is critically endangered, even though it occurs throughout sub-Saharan Africa. It doesn't like to nest near humans, which limits its range, and it's at very, very low density and massively declining. But I've seen it on each trip that I've led to Ethiopia. So that's the white-headed vulture. lammergeiers. Not a lot of people realise, but there's a little pocket of lammergeiers much further south than the normal range. And unlike where I've seen them in Europe and the Himalayas, they're often just gliding back past a few feet away, full adults as well there. You can see the beard and the eye colour. You can almost reach out and touch them. And lanner falcons as well. Lanner is a real sought-after bird in Europe, whereas as soon as you get down to Ethiopia, you're seeing them almost on a daily basis. And all these photographs I've taken myself on the tours. So, you know, they're not agency photographs. This is the kind of views that we were getting there. And Rob suggested vulture-eyed guinea fowl was the ugliest bird on the planet. I think this one must be a contender, but it's beautifully ugly. This is the thick-billed raven, and just look at that head and bill. They're absolutely fantastic and bigger than our ravens as well, and our ravens are pretty massive. But this is another bird that we're seeing on a daily basis, and this is endemic to the Horn of Africa. Usually when they say endemic, it's usually the adjacent parts of Eritrea as well, but it's a Horn of Africa endemic. This is another endemic from of the Horn of Africa. This is the wattled ibis, and you can see why it's named that, because it's got that little flap of skin that hangs down from its chin. That's its wattle, but they're very, very common, the kind of birds that you will be seeing regularly in good numbers. They nest on the cliffs in that kind of area, but at lower altitudes, they tend to nest in trees. And this is one of the rarest mammals in Africa. This is the Wallia ibex. It's much darker than the Nubian ibex and well separated from it. It's got a tiny little range in the Simien Mountains. And in 1994, the population was down to about 200 animals, but special protection and persuading the locals not to kill and eat them has meant that the numbers have now built up to about 500, but it's still a very rare animal. This is the only place that you can see it. Geladas are another Horn of Africa endemic. This is the high altitude. I was going to say baboon because they look like baboons, but they're not really. They're completely unrelated to the other baboons. The other monkeys, they're in a family all by themselves. And they roost on the cliffs at night because of jackals and leopards and things like that. And then in the mornings, they all spread out and they feed like a herd of wildebeest. They chomp on the grass. And they're completely oblivious to humans. They just come along and they're constantly communicating with each other with little grunts and squeaks, and they barely even notice you. Look at this. This is one of our tour participants that just sat in the grassland and all the geladas sort of gather around him there. This is the alpha male with the troop. Another name for them is bleeding heart baboon, because you can see that. Well, it's not really a heart, is it? It's more like a sort of a sexy cleavage triangle on his chest. But he is the alpha male, and the alpha male will hold a harem of females, usually up to about eight. But because the sexes are produced in the same numbers, that means that for every harem holding male, there is a group of seven males that aren't getting anything, and they really resent this, and so they move around like a big pack of skinheads, challenging males for their harem, and they have some pretty spectacular fights. Here's the harem holder on the left with the champion there, and all his mates sort of egging him on like a schoolyard fight, and you can see they do that lip flip with the baring their teeth, and the females watch this, and the male has to fight for his life on harem, because if he doesn't fight hard enough, then he's out on his ear, and the harem will go off with the rival there. Anyway, leaving the Simien Mountains, we head down some typical Ethiopian roads where livestock seems to wander the streets, the roads willy-nilly, and then you go past some agricultural land where there's huge numbers of common cranes and birds like Erlanger's lark, and both Montagues and pallid harriers as well are very common in this kind of habitat. That one happens to be a pallid harrier, but I could have equally shown you a Montagues there. This is the long-crested eagle. Again, very, very common as you're driving along, seeing many of these each day. Normally, they have a habit of sitting on utility poles right next to the road. So it's actually quite difficult to get one on something that's approaching photogenic. But here's one on a tree anywhere. Look at that fantastic crest on it as well. Going on to the next stop, this is a place called Wendo Genet, which is a tropical rainforest and mountains. And here you get a whole suite of different species. Everybody's been mentioning turacos. This is the white-cheeked turaco, which is another Horn of Africa endemic, one of the high-altitude specialists. The silvery-cheeked hornbill, that's a great big brute of a hornbill, one of the largest of the normal tree-dwelling hornbills as well. Very, very common in Ethiopia. And that's the woodland kingfisher, as has already been alluded to by the others tonight. Kingfishers aren't always over water. You sometimes get woodland ones that sit on perches and go and hunt on insects and scorpions and things on the forest floor. And I think we've already had a beautiful sunbird this evening as well, but lots of different sunbirds in Ethiopia, and that just happens to be a beautiful bird. And we've even had colobuses tonight. Lots and lots of colobuses. These are even in the hotel grounds in Wendo Genet and in other places as well. They're an animal that we see an awful lot of very, very close. You get great views. And as Rob said, these are the Guereza colobus, because it's been split into a number of species. The on to our next camp. This is at Awash National Park, and this is the Awash Falls. This is taken from the camp. We camp right next to this spectacular waterfall, and within the water, right below the falls, is a good population of Nile crocodiles here. Nobody goes wandering in the water in that area. There really are quite a lot of them. You see things like Goliath herons and spurwing plovers there by the water. Everybody's been mentioning bee eaters, but Rob showed you a front view. Here's a back view. These are little bee eaters, but there's lots of blue-chested bee eaters and others as well. And that's an Abyssinian roller. That's a real roadside bird. You'll see lots of these on a daily basis. And that's one of my favourite of the African starlings. I'm glad nobody showed this so far. This is the violet-backed starling, also known as the amethyst starling. Violet is actually quite a rare colour in nature. There aren't many things that are as purple as that, genuinely purple, and I think that starling really does it. It's brilliant. So a different kind of hornbill. This is von der Decken's hornbill. Again, we get these near our wash there. And as Rob alluded to, this is the Somali ostrich. You can see it's got a blue neck rather than the pink neck. There's a few other differences as well, but this is the much rarer and more range restricted of the two ostrich species. Arabian bustard, this was taken at Awash. Again, despite the name, they don't actually breed on the Arabian Peninsula. If you've got any of the old Collins field guides to the Western Palearctic, you'll see this sneaks on, because it used to breed in the south of Morocco, but I think it's disappeared from there now, and it's only in sub-Saharan Africa. But it's, again, not a difficult bird to see there at, in Awash. And that's where there's also another big population of the Baser oryx, which is the one that Rob mentioned you get in Kenya there. That's lesser kudu galloping through. It's quite a scrubby habitat here as well. It's not open grassland plains here. That's a salt's dik-dik, tiny little antelope that was moving through the camp at Awash one morning. And Summering's gazelle as well. That's another range-restricted Horn of Africa speciality. There's very, very few places you can see Summering's gazelle, and Ethiopia's the place to see it. And this is the largest flying bird. It's the Kori bustard, and it weighs about 3 stones, 42 pounds. Compare that to your Christmas turkey and imagine that taking flight under its own steam. Also, we saw, but I never managed to get a photograph, the northern carbine bee eaters sitting on their backs as they walk through the grassland and using them as a perch. So, which I think is the only example of a bird that regularly uses another bird as a perch there. But anyway, the largest flying bird, we get those at Awash. And just there's a lot of Palearctic migrants as well that move through into Africa for the winter. And this one was just hopping around outside our tents one day. This just happens to be a white-throated robin, which is quite a scarce southeastern Europe species, very sought after by European bird watchers, but just a feature of the camp there. So onto the Rift Valley lakes, there's a range of lakes, mostly freshwater, but a few soda lakes. So you do see things like the lesser flamingo and two species of pelican. These are great white pelicans, but there are good numbers of pink-backed pelicans as well. And there's huge numbers of birds attracted to the water. The terns are a mixture of whiskered, white-winged black and gold-billed terns. And all those darker things that look like giant swallows below them are actually collared pratincoles. Big numbers of that. I've seen more collared pratincoles on the lakes in Ethiopia than I've seen in the rest of my life in any of the breeding colonies in Europe and anywhere really. So another Palearctic common bird is the black-headed wagtail. Again, this is the common form that you find in places like Greece, but it's a common bird in Ethiopia, a great one to see just as a little padding bird there. And as Rob mentioned, this is the black heron. There it is with its glaring yellow feet, even more contrasting than the little egret. But I managed to get a photograph of it doing its mantling. I presume that the reason why they do this is because the fish do like shade, and they come and rest in the shade, and then that enables the heron to pick them off. But there it is actually doing the umbrella. So hippos, lots of hippos in the Rift Valley lakes as well. And I mentioned malachite kingfishers as well. Other people have mentioned that tiny little kingfisher. You do get giant kingfishers and other ones, African pygmy, but malachite is the very common one, and pied as well. And I've just rather spoilt the punchline if you were very quick there, but the little secret I was going to let you into is that hippopotamuses absolutely hate malachite kingfishers. They're infuriated by them. And if you want to see the evidence, here you go. Look at that. If you look top left there, you can see a malachite kingfisher being seen off by an angry hippo there. On to the next site. This is the Guasse grasslands. This is a high altitude site on the edge of the Bale Mountains. The grasslands are full of prey, mammals, and you get a lot of predators there, the vultures in particular, and also birds like the steppe eagle here. It's a very common Palearctic migrant down into Africa. You get tawny eagles as well. That's the Abyssinian longclaw. It looks a bit like a meadowlark from America, but it's actually related to the pipits, a very colourful and common bird in the grasslands there. This is a much rarer, more elusive, highly sought after bird. This is the Ethiopian ground thrush, and this was in the nearby Dinsho Reserve. It's also a great place for owls. I saw several species of owl, far more here, but this is just four random photographs, all taken from the Guasse Dinsho area. Top left is a Verro's eagle owl. Top right is an African wood owl. Bottom right is the Cape eagle owl. And bottom left is the Abyssinian long-eared owl there. But, such a great place for owls there. This is this tiny little antelope is a shy thing called the duiker. That's a juvenile just seen as we walk through. But the main thing that people go for are the Menelix bushbuck, which is the darkest of the bushbuck subspecies, and this one, the mountain nyala. This was actually the last large mammal that was discovered in Africa. Most of the others have been discovered long since, even all the rare stuff like pygmy hippos and okapis. This one remained eluded everybody because it was such in an out of the way place at high altitude. So it was only discovered in 1910. This is the mountain nyala. You can see it's got an adamant stripe across its nose, a really, really handsome beast. But again, quite common in Dinsho, not one that you'd really struggle to see up there. On the grasslands itself, I've seen serval on every trip there. So you don't get things like lions and cheetahs, but you do get the smaller cats. There are caracals there as well, but I've not been lucky enough to see those. The reason why the servals are here is because of the large numbers of rodents. And I've put this in because this is an Ethiopian striped mouse. And I've looked this up on the internet, on Google Images and Bing Images. And the only photograph I can find by typing its name and its scientific name came into the images is one dead one that was used for a scientific paper. So this may be a really special photograph. Who knows? You've been looking at lions and all this big stuff, but the small stuff is good too. Ethiopian striped mouse. And this is one of the rarest animals in Africa. This is the bamboo-feeding Bale monkey. It's the Bale Mountains. There's a little band of bamboo in the tropical forest there, and the monkey only lives in that bamboo band within the at a certain altitude within the Bale Mountains. A full survey has been done, and they only found 773 animals recently. And that makes it about three times as rare as giant pandas, which is the other big bamboo feeding mammal on the planet. So there are hardly any photographs of this. You know, very few people see them, but we've seen them on all our tours that we've done to Ethiopia. We seek them out and try hard. This one, it reminds me of Uncle Albert off Only Fools and Horses. Look at it with that great big buffy white beard. But it's, yeah, very special one indeed. We've mentioned a ground hornbill. These things are over a metre tall. They've got a 6-foot wingspan, and they're, you know, regularly seen in Ethiopia. We usually bump into them on a number of occasions, but usually you just see them wandering around in the grasslands like this. But I also managed to photograph one in flight. They've got a 6-foot wingspan and great big triangles of white in their outer primaries. Really spectacular birds in flight. So that's the Abyssinian ground hornbill, or the northern ground hornbill, as Ben said earlier. They're the ones that have got blue around the eye rather than pink. Right, and onto the last place, which is the Seneti Plateau. This is very high altitude, but we've got to go up, you know, much higher than Dincho. It goes to about 14,000 feet at the highest. And when you start getting to the high altitudes, you see other specialized animals. This is the Klip Springer, and this little animal lives on the cliffs. And you can see here, it walks on its tiptoes. I wonder how it managed to do this, but taking photographs like this, each of its hooves are cloven, and it's like having eight little walking sticks with it. You know those hiking poles that people use, like ski sticks? It's like having those, so it can leap, and there's always one of them that's holding on in the onto the precarious cliffs that it inhabits. It's a tiny little thing as well, you know, smaller than a muntjac. That's the Klip Springer. And up at this kind of altitude, it gets really cold. You're almost on the equator, but the pools freeze over in the evening. When you're up there at first light, it really is quite chilly there. You see, again, endemic birds to the Ethiopian highlands. This is the moorland francolin. Again, you don't see that many photographs of these on the internet. They're, you know, a sought-after and scarce species. Another endemic to the Ethiopian highlands here. That's the spot-breasted lapwing that breeds in the grasslands there. And another one that we never have any problem finding is the Rougier's rail. Again, this is the only place on the planet that it occurs. You've got to go high up on the Bale Mountain Plateau to be able to see this specialist. But the reason why people come up here is to actually see that animal there. You scan across the high altitude, which has got sort of grey coloured lichen covered rocks and grey bushes, and you can just see in the middle there, that is an Ethiopian wolf. That's the rarest canid on the planet, the rarest member of the dog family. It only occurs in about 6 spots, all of them in Ethiopia, and the total population on the planet numbers only 400. But one of those sites, which is the Seneti Plateau and the Bale Mountains, has about 200 animals. So it's a fair bet that you see them. And you'll be reassured to hear that you do get better views than that. Here's one that we found resting just by the side of the road. And they're completely oblivious. It's so difficult to get one even to look at you for a photograph because they just completely ignore you. They just carry on. This is the main thing that they feed on. This is the giant mole rat, which again is a really rare, only found on the Seneti Plateau, endangered mole rat. Its eyes are situated on the top of its head, so it can stick its head above the parapet without exposing the whole body to have a look for Ethiopian wolves. And these things weigh about 1 pound 6 ounces. Imagine that. It's like a guinea pig on steroids, really big things. But that's mainly what the Ethiopian wolves are feeding on. And one of the threats to the habitat is people doing illegal grazing up on the plateau. But what we noticed is that the Ethiopian wolves use the herds of grazing animals as stalking horses. So they hide behind horses or cows and get close to them, because the mole rats are oblivious to those, get close to them and then snap them up with their long muzzles. They can get right down the holes there and pull them out. But this, you get really good views of these, and that is the highlight of the tour, the rarest canid on the planet. Anyway, everyone else has finished with the sunset, so here's one of mine, and that's a yellow-billed kite sailing into the sunset in Ethiopia. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tim, and to Rob before you. So we're going to go to some questions now. Shall I get rid of your shared screen, Tim?
Yeah. I can. Yes, please do. Oh, that's gone.
My view option button is not working for me.
I think it's gone. Yeah, Cara, it's gone off my screen. Yes. Yeah.
We're there. Great. So welcome back to all our panellists. So we've got about 20 minutes or so now to answer any questions that you might have. So please pop them in the Q&A box if you do have any. I've just scribbled down a few that we've been seeing during the evening. So I'll kick off with a few of those just to get us going. So Ben, there was a good one which I have had in the office in recent weeks about the chances, particularly percentage chances of pangolins in Ghana. Now, I have said to people that was a new itinerary that we established for last year. So obviously it hasn't run yet because it was scuppered by COVID. So we can't tell you how many of our tours have seen pangolin yet because we haven't run them yet. But maybe Ben, you could just share your experience during your trip there last November and how easy or hard you found it.
Yeah, sure. So one of the reasons why I decided to go to Ghana was because I really wanted to see pangolins. Some of you might be familiar with the mammal watching website. It's a really great resource with a whole set of trip reports from all over the world. But generally speaking, if you're after elusive mammals and you want to find out sort of locations to see them, it's a great place to look. So that's what first kind of alerted me to the idea of Ghana being a good place to go. There are lots of reports on there of people going to Ghana looking specifically for pangolins and finding them. In my experience with elusive wildlife, it really helps to look for stuff. Often you go to place, and that sounds pretty simplistic, but a lot of the time, in my experience, people don't try and assume that things are just too elusive, too difficult to find, when actually a little bit of understanding of the behavior of the animals and some sort of targeted searching can turn up, can produce much higher success rates than you would ever get if you were just on a birding tour, say, and picking up mammals and other things like that purely passively. So the idea behind this, and I obviously went to Ghana and was successful in finding this black-bellied pangolin, having told our guides that that was one of the things I really wanted to see. And my impression, and again, we can't back this up necessarily with statistics from Naturetrek tours, but my impression is that the chances of seeing them in Ghana on a dedicated trip are, it's really not out of the question. No one sensible would ever say, we guarantee that you will see wild pangolins. That would be irresponsible, actually. And part of the problem is that, because they are so heavily poached, the situation can change. But one anecdote that the guide I had when I was out there told us, he was guiding a Naturetrek tour himself not that long ago, and he was out with a birding group, and they saw 5 black-bellied pangolins in one afternoon walk, and none of the group cared at all because they were all totally dead keen serious birders. And I think he was pretty upset with that. So it's always a matter of luck. There are approaches you can follow to improve your chances. One of the things we do is we're aiming to do is use local guides, particularly in the Bikathartes forest, to go out and scan the forest for them. When you find one, they can often be quite noisy. So actually covering a lot of ground is a good approach. I would go, I want to go back, I want to look for them again. I looked for them myself, I was successful. Lots of other people have been following a dedicated approach. That's all I can say really. I wouldn't say they're guaranteed, but there is a better chance there than probably anywhere else.
Perfect, thanks Ben, that's really helpful. Couple of questions on Ethiopia, perhaps that Tim and I can handle between us. Mm-hmm. So one that came up before, I thought I might go into a little bit more detail now, was someone asked if our tours are primarily birding. Now, my straight answer to that is no. We have four different itineraries. We have a mammal-focused bargain trip, a birding-focused bargain trip. We've got our Best of Ethiopia tour, which is comprehensible round wildlife. And we have a wildlife and history tour, which also goes to Lalibela and the rock-hewn churches there. But I think, Tim, would you agree with me that it's fair to say that the birds are the predominant member of the fauna in Ethiopia? It's not like visiting somewhere where you've got vast plains of mammals jumping out at you all over the place. So,
I would definitely agree with that, Kerry. I've actually led the bargain mammals tour, and you know, we saw all the mammals we wanted to see, but we also had time to see birds, and you know, people are quite interested when you've got species of owls sitting there and lots of pretty birds. I mean, they weren't that interested in the little brown jobs, admittedly, but you know, people do like to see the lammergeiers and the eagles and things like that, and we certainly don't miss any mammals by looking at birds.
Yeah absolutely. And there's a question about the accommodation and food. Now accommodation for sure, it does not compare with the sort of luxurious camps of Kenya and Tanzania and especially sub-Saharan Africa. For me, it was kind of what I expected going to Ethiopia. I think the first place I stayed in was Awash Falls Lodge, which was very in the middle of nowhere, eco lodge, pretty basic, but just felt, I absolutely loved it, but it is basic in parts.
It is. Yeah, I mean, you eat, it's al fresco. I mean, it's covered, but it's all opened up, and you know, you can hear the sounds of the savannah at night, and the crickets chirping, and the owls and things. And the food was fine. I thought it was good. You know, the accommodation was as good as could be expected. The lodges at the Simeon lodges up in the Simeon Mountains were great.
That's had a refurb as well recently. I think over COVID they've taken time to redo everything, so yeah. The one place is where we stay for the Bali Mountains is not great.
I was just going to mention that, but when I stayed there the first time, Kate Ady was staying there with a team from the BBC, and when we were chatting to them, they said, well, there's nowhere else to stay, you know, if you want to go and see Ethiopian wolves, there's this hotel, or you know, several hours away on the other side of the plateau there is another hotel, and that would just take too long, so you know, you have to make do. But even that isn't that bad, you know. It was good enough for Kate Ady. It was good enough for me.
Right, oh, lots of questions coming in now, let's get going. This is a nice one for the West African specialists amongst us. How lychee are West African rainforests? I don't think they have them in Ghana, do they, Ben? Do they?
I was actually just trying to Google it, actually, because
I don't think they have lychees in Ghana.
I mean, there are lychees, but not, as far as I'm aware, that I certainly didn't encounter any biting lychees. And, you know, having been to rainforests elsewhere in the world where, you know, you can be pestered by them constantly, it was never anything that I was told to be aware of, and it was never bitten by anything. As far as I can tell from a very quick Google search, there aren't biting lychees, although there are other kind of lychees in those forests. So no, not a concern.
Thank you. What sort of fitness is needed for Ethiopia? That's one from Stephen.
It's not, you know, you're not walking great distances. You know, we tend to move from place to place in the van and then get out and have a short walk. The Joe Reserve, that does take a little bit of walking, but again, it's nothing too strenuous, and no. You know, you can You can take lesser options if you want. You might not see everything that everybody else is going to see, but it's not, it really isn't strenuous or dangerous. It's,
I would agree with that. I think you feel the altitude in the Simien Mountains when you first get up there. And we do take time. We don't fly you straight into the Simien Mountains. You're staying at over 3,000 metres there. But we'll start off in Addis, and then which is at over 2,000 metres, and then we'll have a night in Bahadar, and then you'll be up in Simien. So you've sort of acclimatised a bit along the way. So I know when I was there, I felt out of breath a bit, and I think I had a bit of a headache the first night. But it wasn't like stopping me walking or anything, so you can take it really easy. And whilst we're on Ethiopia, there's lots of Ethiopians on here actually. Someone's asked about the political situation in Ethiopia at the moment, and does it put a question mark on trips? Well, yes, to an extent. At the moment, obviously, the Foreign Office is advising against travel to Ethiopia because of COVID, but also because of the political unrest that's been in the country over the last few months. I was in touch with our local agents last week. They were feeling optimistic for the autumn, provided COVID sorts itself out in time. They were hopeful that we'd be back up and running in the autumn. So yes, there was a question mark, but to be honest, no more so than most places in the world at the moment. So it's just a wait and see, really, how that pans out. And we wouldn't be running our tours if there is still lots of political unrest and it's dangerous to go, then the Foreign Office will continue to advise against travel and we won't be operating. So anyone that's booked, we'll offer a full refund or get you rebooked for next year and keep fingers firmly crossed. Some questions on Murchison coming in. Georgie, I don't know if you might know the answers to these ones about the new road being built to access oil by the Delta.
Yeah, that's been going on for quite a while now. It was there when I was there a few years ago. So to be honest, it's not something I've had a very recent update on. Certainly we can find out for you and find out what the most recent situation is and get back to you on that one.
Okay, yeah. So a couple of questions have come in. One that I typed a bit of an answer to and I said I'd come back to, so I will come back to it now because it's been brought up again, is the differences between bargain trips and normal trips. So this is quite a difficult one to answer sometimes because over the years they've all morphed. And originally I would say our bargain trips were generally distinguished because they were entirely locally guided as opposed to having a UK tour leader going out with the group. However, that does not always differentiate it now because in a lot of cases our local guides are so good. Sorry, chaps here. We just don't always need you to go along as well. So we quite a few of our normal trips around Africa now are also purely locally guided. Sometimes it's to do with the accommodation, so we might stay in more luxurious places on our normal tours, but more basic accommodation on the bargain tours. Again, it doesn't always work like that. For example, in Kenya, we stay in a really lovely, almost luxurious camp. I think where else we do? Our Botswana, we'll do Botswana next week, but we stay in a really nice camps then, that sort of thing. So again, it's not always that helpful. And sometimes it's a time of year. So for example, back to Kenya, we do go just slightly out of peak season for our bargain tours. So we tend to go at the very end of October and into November, which is the start of the short rain. So you're just out of the peak high price range brings the price down a bit for that reason. So, yeah, it's not a very easy question to answer, but our bargain tours really are our most popular trips. They're fabulous, good value for money for many reasons. But yeah, some of our real best trips around Naturetrek are those bargain tours. Hopefully that helps answer your question a little bit. What else have we got? We had a question about single travellers. That comes up quite a bit. We always very welcome on our tours. We tend to have a really nice mix of single travellers and couples, friends travelling together. Sometimes people will meet on an Naturetrek tour and then start travelling together in the future. That's really nice as well. But you're always welcome as a single traveller. If you'd like to share a room, then we will look to pair you up with someone else so you can share throughout. And we do advertise that on our website as well. So it will tell you there's a male or female share available before you book. Or if you'd rather have a single room, then you can book a single room from the start, and there's normally a single room supplement to cover that. Right, any further questions? Let's have a look. Just going through. There was one about malaria and the food. I think, George, you answered that one. I assume that was referring to Uganda.
Yeah, I did think that. Yeah. I'm not sure what that was referring to, but in terms of Uganda,
yeah,
it's definitely advisable to take malarial prophylactics before you leave. And it's also very important to note that if you're going to Uganda, you'll need a yellow fever certificate, but we do know a lot of our clients are advised not to get a yellow fever certificate for medical reasons, and in that case you can just get an exemption certificate from your doctor, so it won't prevent you from traveling. But yes, definitely need malarial prophylactics, definitely need a yellow fever certificate. In terms of food, it's usually very, very nice, very, very plentiful. We can cater for vegetarian diets very easily on any of our tours to any of these destinations, I would say, really. You probably just need to perhaps not get so much variety as you might expect in other places. And we can cater for most other dietary requirements as well. We just always ask that you let us know beforehand, just so that we can let the lodges know and make sure there's good supplies of the food that you need.
I think that would probably go for any of the tours we've talked about this evening. I think malaria prophylactics required throughout. Some of them require yellow fever certificates, and yeah, give us a heads up on the special diets and we'll make sure you're catered for. Georgie, there was another question from Caroline. Said she was lucky enough to meet the Windy Gorillas before lockdown kicked in. How do you think the gorilla and chimpanzee treks will change as a result of COVID?
Yeah, so actually it's something that we've been a little bit concerned about sort of all the way since COVID's been the pandemic, obviously, because they do share so much DNA with us. It's a bit concerning of how they might react. There's not been a lot of research on it so far, so they don't really know. But they have started gorilla treks again, just with extra protocols in place. So previously you didn't actually have to wear a mask when you were doing gorilla treks, whereas you do now. And we may well see sort of extra precautions being put in the future. They're not getting many people doing the gorilla treks at the moment. Obviously, not many people are able to travel, but I imagine they'll be very tight on that when we can start again.
Perfect. Thank you, Georgie. Ben, a question for you here from Rachel. Are there any recommended extensions that can be done from the Ghana pangolins trip? I would just add before that we can do extensions almost anywhere, but over to Ben who for your personal recommendation.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially if you're interested in birds in particular, there are a few forests that neither of our main tours do visit. I'd say from my perspective, the most unique one that I went to when I was there is the Atiwa Forest. It's one of the only examples of upper elevation Guinea forest left in West Africa, and it's home to a pretty remarkable variety of species that are really hard to see elsewhere. It's a bit more of a sort of birder's destination than a general wildlife enthusiast type place. But things like blue moustached bee eater, which is a really, really gorgeous bird that's quite localized, nimba flycatcher, which is hardly ever seen. Our guide, when I was there, when we saw one, was sort of almost hit the ceiling because he was so excited. But it's a pretty plain looking bird. So unless you're kind of a global lister, it might be underwhelming. But generally speaking, the diversity of birds there was amazing. The only problem with this is that there's a danger it might be clear felled very soon for a Chinese backed aluminium mine. But it's a wonderful forest, and yeah, that would be at the top of my list, but there are lots of other places around that can be added to the tour.
Perfect, thanks, Ben. Another leech question, Georgie. Leeches in Uganda?
That one. Yeah. To be honest, I'm not too sure if leeches specifically are a problem. I would say that there can be quite a few biting insects when you're doing your gorilla treks in particular. So you'll want to definitely tuck your trousers into your socks, as otherwise it can get quite uncomfortable. But leeches specifically, I'm not too sure about. So I'll have to take a look and get back to you on that one.
Sure thing. Martin's asked about the areas for southern Ethiopian endemics of basic accommodation. Correct. Do you know if better accommodation is being developed down there? I'm not totally sure, to be honest. I haven't heard much recently.
As far as I was aware, that on the far side of the plateau where the valley monkeys are, that there are some ecologies there that are supposed to be better, but it's so difficult to access to get over there. It would restrict all your, you know, all the other grow on the north side of the plateau. You wouldn't be able to do so. And the accommodation isn't that bad. The one that Kate Ady was at, you know, it's not what you would call 5-star luxury, but it's certainly adequate. You know, the food was fine.
Yeah. So that's around the Bali Mountains. So there are literally two options there. The hotel in Goba that we're talking about, that we stay at on our best of tours. And then it's literally 2 hours drive over the plateau, down the Hirena Forest, and then, a good probably 2 hours drive. That's the Bali Mountain Lodge, which is lovely. I have stayed there and it was very nice. But it's significantly more expensive, as well as being 2 hours drive away. And we're talking hundreds of dollars a night more expensive. And I have just never thought it was quite worth it. Even people grumbling about, very slow service in the restaurant and things for the hotel in Goba, I don't think it's worth the extra amount of driving and the significant extra cost. We sometimes organise tailor-made holidays, and if you go stay for longer, and depending on what your focus is going to be, well, it can be a really nice place to stay. But I wouldn't say for these particular trips we've been talking about this evening, it's worth it. I don't know if Martin was talking about going a lot further south, which you can do, like to the Omo Valley, which we don't include on any of our itineraries at the moment. That's not to say we won't in the future, we don't have them in place at the moment. Georgie, remember you and I were talking to the chap from Simeon Mountain Lodge, and he was off down there. He'd fixed up some sort of incredible air conditioning and like beer fridge system to his roof and was heading off down south. But I can't remember now what you reported back on in terms of accommodation. Pretty basic stuff, I think. Right, I think we're over time, so we'll just literally wrap up these questions here. Kate asked, how often, if at all, do you see wild dog in Kenya? I don't know that we do, Rob, do we?
Not on the tours that we go to. There is a conservancy in the centre of Kenya, a very exclusive one, where they have them and are regularly seen. But certainly in the Mara, pretty much unheard of, although they do range widely and they are in the Serengeti, so they could turn up one day. But to be honest, if you really want to see wild dog, Botswana, Zambia, that's your best bet.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Perfect. I think that about covers it. So we will stay on just for another minute or so, just in case any of the questions. But otherwise, I would like to thank all of our lovely panelists this evening for joining us. I've thoroughly enjoyed all of your talks. I hope everyone else has too. I'm sure they have. Thank you to all of you for tuning in and listening this evening. If there's any of our previous roadshows that you've missed and would like to listen into, then they're all on our website, so you can just pop on there. There's a big banner on the homepage. Click on that. You'll find the links and the passwords to watch them. We'll be back next Wednesday, I believe it is, and we'll be taking you to Southern Africa at that time, so all around South Africa and Botswana. So if you fancy going a bit further south, then do join us next Wednesday. If you're a member of a local history society or an RSPB club, anything like that, and would like a Naturetrek speaker for your next meeting, then please let us know. We offer free talks to local RSPB groups and the likes. So again, pop on our website and have a look, and get in touch if you'd like to get one of us booked in. And I think that's all we have time for. So as I said, we'll stay on here just for another minute or so, just in case any last minute questions. But otherwise, thank you again and good night.
Okay, thanks.